Well, good morning. Good to be together in the Lord. Welcome to St. John's. A couple quick announcements here this morning as we begin our time in worship. For those here, those online, welcome. A couple quick announcements. So number one, next weekend we have a congregational town hall meeting. This was announced last weekend as well, but just a reminder, at 12:15 right here in the sanctuary. So worship at your normal time or choose to worship at 11 and then pretty much following that service. A couple minutes to get organized. We'll get started by 12:15 in the sanctuary. God's people, come on out, be a part of the conversation, be a part of God's work in mission and vision together. Also going to ask for some help in spreading the word a little bit about communion and how we're handling that. We've transitioned from in-vehicle communion for those who are not able to join us in person yet. We've transitioned that to communion appointments. So if you know people who are not yet worshiping in person for various reasons, maybe COVID-related, maybe others, but need to take communion like we are this weekend, we want to get the word out that we are hosting communion appointments again on November 11th, 11 to 3 p.m. Okay, November 11th, not 11, it is 1 to 3 p.m. 11 p.m., you want to be here at 11 p.m.? No, I don't either. So 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. on November 11th. The key is, though, you have to call the church office to reserve an appointment. About 10-minute sections, there are only people coming in and out for that 10 minutes, receive the Lord's Supper, and be blessed in that way, strengthened in faith. So get the word out. If you know people in that situation, let them know. November 11th, not 11 p.m., but 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. It has been such a blessing for us to go through this journey of households of faith. It's a sermon series that we're kind of wrapping up today, but not really. It carries through the rest of the ministry year, and it's been so exciting to put out resources for people to engage in as we ask God to help us grow in our vibrancy within our households. And we gave out the books, the Building a Vibrant Household book, sponsored by the foundation, and we basically gave away all the copies. There were two left this morning that we had on hand. They're probably gone already, and we say praise God. And we had the conversation decks, these tools that are out there for us to have these spiritual conversations within our household. And those were gone before even 11 o'clock service that same day. And more are on the way. They're backordered of all things, and we'll put them out when we get them. But we are thankful to have these resources as we ask God to build the vibrancy within our households, because we know he's at work in our households. And there's another resource out there at the table. I didn't bring mine up, but it's a little magnet with paper on it that kind of you'd make your grocery lists and stuff, but this is a different kind of list. It goes through the pillars of households of faith within sharing hospitality, spiritual conversations, and spiritual disciplines, and it says, this month my household will. And it's a way for us as we've come through this series to make steps, to make plans, to set goals that we would take action in the way God would have for us to live out as households of faith. Pick up one of those magnets and use it as a household and continue to be in the conversation as God grows a vibrancy within your own household. We're also blessed this weekend to look beyond the immediate and extended households and look at God's larger household, the church. This weekend is All Saints Weekend, and we are honoring those saints that were newly brought into God's family through the gift of baptism over the course of this year. We are also recognizing the way God brings victory to his people and for those who are the church triumphant, awaiting God's return at rest in him. There'll be a slideshow with all the people throughout this year that we might reflect on God's work through the church, the larger church. And it is good to know that we're family. The God who brought us into this family that transcends all of time is here with us as we gather in his name. We rise for our opening song.
We need your power, need our Gathered this morning on a beautiful, blessed Sunday morning around the baptismal font, and we gather and we are called in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we pray. Standing with the great multitude of saints before the throne of God and the Lamb, let us join in prayer, praise, and thanksgiving to the God of our salvation. Heavenly Father, you are a mighty and eternal God. Today, we remember before you the saints and martyrs of every generation who trusted in you in the face of terror and threat. As our time approaches, Lord, give us the courage that when facing persecution, we will not back away, nor will we be silent. But may we be zealous and bold in defending our faith and our natural right to worship you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we beg your grace that our lives may be ordered by your commands, and we ask you to bless those who govern us in your name. Lord, bless Donald, our president, the Congress. Bless Tony, our governor, the legislature, and all local officials, all police, and all who serve us, pursuing the path of justice, that they may act with humility and honor for the good of all people. Give wisdom to all who are going to go vote this week. Lord, bless the result of the election and that our nation may elect leaders peacefully and orderly. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you have blessed us in so many different ways. Lord, I ask that we do not receive your blessing and remain passive, but we now go out and act boldly according to your will. And may our presence and our activities among our communities show that our common life together within your church may be known to those who do not yet know you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you have made us your children, and you continue to guard us as your own possession. Lord, according to your will, we ask that you give healing to those of us who are sick. Give calm to the troubled in mind and patience to those who are facing sorrows and struggles. Lord, especially this morning, we hold up to you Bob Korth and Jacob Montanez. Lord, as they heal Lord, we pray for your healing hand to be upon them and those who are in their care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, show forth your kindness to the poor and your compassion to those who suffer injustice. Lord, deliver us from the scourge of racism and prejudice, and help us to acknowledge that we are all your children, all created by you, and all equal in your sight. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty and eternal God, bring us to that day when every tear shall be wiped from our eyes, and we shall hunger or thirst no more. Knowing you now by faith, we yearn for the day when we shall know you face to face. Until the dawn of that beautiful day, Lord, keep us in your faith and fear through our good shepherd and our Lord, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading comes from 1 John chapter 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. This is the word of the Lord.
With faith and valor, when faced with trials or nails. strife. Give grace for every hurdle that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful.
The second reading comes from Revelation chapter 7. After this, I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these clothed in white robes, and from where have they come?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst no more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Nicole. Please rise for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the fifth chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets that were before you." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. We've spent the last 6 weeks and really this fall talking about households of faith and what it means so that our households can be places where the Christian faith is nurtured and encouraged and grows. We've spoken about what it means to be a household, that God has given us both immediate family and kind of an extended household of people who pass through from time to time, or maybe a little bit too often in some cases. We've spoken about what God gives us, the tools that God gives us to grow and strengthen faith in our own homes. And today, as we kind of wrap up at least this portion, we kind of take the lens from being zoomed all the way in to all the way out. And we speak about God's greater household, the church, that we gathered here through the waters of our baptism and all who have gone before us in the faith are members of God's greater household, that he has prepared and set apart his family from the beginning, washed us white in the waters of baptism, and made us his people for this time and this place through all eternity. God's greater household, the church. But that's hard to see. And I found this fine picture on the internet when we talk about a reading from Revelation, right? 2020's been quite the year, hasn't it? Pandemic, riots, murder hornets. Do you remember those? They were in the news cycle for 2 days. And this picture's rather humorous in a sense. It testifies to something deeper. That 2020 has been an interesting year. Now, to be sure, and to be fair, we have no idea if 2020 is something that is particularly spelled out in the book of Revelation. But I do know in the chapter before our second reading today, we see a pretty gruesome picture. The Lamb opens the seals on the scroll, and God unleashes the four horsemen of the apocalypse, conquering pestilence, disease, warfare, famine, death, Hades. All are unleashed. And it's not as if the devil somehow got out of control. No, it is the Lord bringing his wrath against sinful humanity in this time, in this place. God executes his wrath and his judgment upon wickedness and upon evil. Curiously, these Revelation chapter 6 never seems to make it into our readings for church. Curiously. And yet it's there. Now, what I think 2020 has done is it's unsettled us in some way. And I pray that the Lord has used 2020 to do that, to discomfort us, to take away a few things that we trust in, to remind us that we are, in fact, mortal, to remind us that the good and blessed life is not found in stuff or things, to remind us that whether tomorrow, next week, next year, or decades from now, we will die because of the sin we have inherited from Adam and Eve all the way down. And God brings judgments that is meant to discomfort. And 2020 has unsettled many of us, at least just a little bit. But the Apostle John doesn't stop there. In Revelation 7 that Nicole read, we finally get this beautiful picture of all of the saints of God's greater household, the church, gathered around his throne in this heavenly worship scene. There is no more pain. There are no more tears. There is no more hunger or thirst. There is God's greater household, the church, in its completed state. There is no more sin. All who have gone before us in the faith and all of us now, bought by the blood of Jesus, will see this day where we will see our Savior face to face and we will see our loved ones who have gone before us in the faith face to face. This is God's greater household in the perfect, perfected, complete state. But the church has something to say now. As God's greater household of faith, we recognize that each of our individual households are part of one larger household, one group. And in a time and in a place where people are attaching more and more of their identity, their meaning, their purpose, and even their happiness based on being a member of a certain political party or another, a certain larger group, because we're so desperate for meaning and purpose, the church has an opportunity to say, no, our purpose and our meaning and who we are is found as members as of God's greater household that He has put together. This is who we are as church. Members of God's family here in this place. That is who God has called us to be and who He has made us to be. These last couple of weeks, we've talked about these three different sort of activities that take place in households of faith that nourish them, that nourish faith and strengthen it. One is spiritual conversations, like Jesus with the woman at the well. He engages her. Who is this one? Who is this one who is coming? He engages her, right? And that's a practice that is healthy for us to wrestle with what God is doing, not just 2,000 years ago, but in our lives today. This idea of spiritual disciplines or rituals where we engage the Word of God and spend time in prayer, not just as individuals, but together as family. And then extending hospitality. Now, that's weird, isn't it? This is not a time where hospitality is encouraged. And yet, this is what Christians are called to do because we know the one who has been hospitable to us. These things encourage, these things nurture, these things strengthen faith. These things are part and parcel of what it means to be, and that's why we've encouraged them these last weeks. Because they all help us remember where we will be at the end. Is anybody a detail person? Just a minutia detail, you know, down to the, like, you know, how many screws do we have to put this thing together type person, right? Okay. You know, you folks are often accused of seeing lots of trees or seeing one tree in the forest, but you miss the whole forest, right? Now, praise the Lord for people like you, because then we have people like me who only look at the forest and never the individual trees, right? Those practices are individual trees. They all help nurture and strengthen a healthy forest. But the picture that God gives us today is the forest itself. That here is the church in its completed state. Here is God's greater household of faith, washed by the blood of the Lamb, at rest in Christ, face to face with Him and with each other. But goodness gracious, this is hard to see and think about now, isn't it? I did some math. You saw in our slideshow, at least six of those babies, and I think they were all babies, were baptized not here. They were baptized during the shutdown. They were baptized in salad bowls, in living rooms and kitchens, with seven computer screens up so all of the different in-laws and relatives could see what was going on. And yet the work of the greater household of faith went on, even when things were shut down. Did anyone in that list of those who have gone to the church triumphant, those who have died in the faith in the last year, did you see a name where you went, oh my gosh, I didn't realize he or she had passed? Seems to happen every All Saints Day, especially in a church as large as ours. And for some of you, it might have brought back some painful memories of grieving in these recent times, where instead of a church funeral or even a large family get-together to mourn the loss of a loved one, you were scattered outside, 10 or 15 folks, immediate family only, at a graveside, and left to mourn that way. And yet, brothers and sisters, we can take great joy as members of God's greater household of faith that our loved ones are at rest in Christ even now, and at the end we will see them face to face in such a way as God intends. This is the forest, right? This is the larger picture of the church, and we individually are members of it. That is the end of the story. But Pastor, have you looked around? We could talk about the end of the story all that you want, but have you looked around lately? We've got a pandemic. We've got creation torn asunder in the form of wildfires. And if you pay attention to any sort of hurricanes like I used to living in Florida, have you seen? We're like through the list once and it's flipped again already, right? Creation is torn apart. Have you seen the economic worry and anxiety? Have you seen what our 401ks did in the last week? Okay. And then there's murder hornets, right? Which I never thought I'd hear of, but 2020. And then, oh, by the way, do you know what's coming on Tuesday? See, brothers and sisters, there is all sorts of stuff going on. And there will always be all sorts of stuff. Have you heard a politician say this recently? Have you heard this in our discourse, in our conversations? And it's not just in the political realm, but we've got an election in 2 days, so it makes for a great preaching point. But brothers and sisters, I want to warn you of something. It's called the tyranny of the moment. There is this thing that the devil does where he comes along and he says, this is the most important thing. This is the thing to worry about. No, go back. This is the thing that's going to grab our attention. This is the thing that we're going to use to focus on and distract you. This is the thing that you're going to make a mountain out of a molehill. This is the thing we're going to worry about and let anxiety grab us. The tyranny of the moments. It is one way the devil works, and he does it oh so well. Now, to be fair, whoever is elected on Tuesday into whatever office, we will pray for that God would give them wisdom to govern his people as ruling in his left hand. I encourage you, participate as you see fit in the democratic process, as your conscience allows and encourages. But brothers and sisters, don't fall for the lie. Don't fall for the tyranny of the moment. Don't fall for the devil's trap where he says, here's the most important thing. Brothers and sisters, remember God's greater household of faith and the final destination. Okay? The saints before us have lived through plagues and pestilence, warfare and famine, and God has shepherded them through. This is where they are now, at rest in Christ. Listen to how John describes them again. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple, and he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Brothers and sisters, that's the end of the story. Don't let the tyranny of the moment grab you. Don't become so spiritually myopic that we focus only on what's right in front of us, on what we don't have, on what we haven't done, on what we haven't accomplished. You have been bought with the precious blood of Christ, brought into his kingdom. Your eternal fate is secure as a member of God's greater household, the church. We've encouraged these things, these spiritual disciplines and conversations and hospitality, even in this weird time, because they remind us of the end of the story. They remind us in our ways God works, not just in the four walls of the sanctuary, but the four walls of households, to assure us of the end. Do I have any readers in the congregation? Anybody who's like the best idea, the best, most wonderful idea of a day to yourself, because we all get that these days, right? Is to just go home and crack open a book. Any readers like that in the congregation? Yeah. And I pray that someday the Lord would give me that once again. It might happen, right? Does anybody have a book or set of books that they just kind of read over and over again, maybe once a year, twice a year? I've got some favorites that I always turn to when I want a nice, easy read, right? Now, why do I do that? I know the plot. I know who wins and who loses. I know how it's all going to end up, right? And yet, I find myself immersed in these stories once again. Now, perhaps it's not reading, but perhaps it's a film that you love. I know Sean Connery passed away yesterday, I do believe. And I think in his honor, there's some Sean Connery films I love that I will go and watch here soon, when the Lord provides time, right? Brothers and sisters, you know the end of the story. In the midst of pandemic and riots and murder hornets and economic uncertainty, in the midst of an election year where everything is trying to grab us and say, this is the most important thing. In the midst of a result on Wednesday where 40% of you are going to be thrilled, 40% of people, I'll say 40% of people are going to be thrilled, 40% of people are going to be really angry, and 20% are just going to try to avoid either side, right? Don't get caught up in the moment, brothers and sisters. You know the end of the story. So that even in the midst of the pandemic, the plague, the economic uncertainty, or more likely, the cancer diagnosis, the divorce being finalized, the child straying from the faith for a time, or anything else, brothers and sisters, have confidence. Don't let the moment grab you and make you think it's all about then, because you know the end of the story. You have been bought, redeemed, washed white in the blood of the Lamb. You are saints even now, and you will see your Savior face to face. That's the end of the story. Don't let the world try and steal that from you. We as people know our fates. We trust that promise. We hear it read. We know it. Brothers and sisters, you are saints even now, and you as saints will see your Savior face to face. That's the end of the story, and that's a promise you can hold on to forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Speaking of hospitality, I wish I could tell you to shake hands, but I'm going to tell you not to. But instead, I'd still encourage you to stand up, look around, wave hi and good morning, say God's peace, extend some hospitality to your fellow worshipers and friends.
We now have the opportunity to prepare our hearts and our minds before we, in confession and absolution, as we prepare to come to the Lord's table. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. And we pause in reflection. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner,
Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, and by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, I announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we hear the words of our Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat, this is my body." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which has been shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior strengthen you in body and soul to life everlasting. Amen. We pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now, as we go in God's grace and mercy, we have one final opportunity to say thank you, God, for the gift of our households, and to boldly confess, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And so we pray. Lord God, our household is among the most precious gifts we receive in this life. You place us together that we might be a help to each other, that we would support and strengthen the other in faith and for the life to come. As households of faith, we declare before you, give us, O God, the will and the means to be reconciled to you and to one another. Join us to yourself through word and sacrament that we may live together and with you in peace that only you can give. As households of faith, we declare before you,
for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Grant us the virtue of hospitality, the joyful conversations, and the blessing of gathering as households around your word and bringing our prayers before you. As households of faith, we declare before you,
for
me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We receive your loving kindness in our home as a reminder of the eternal home we inherit through your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. As households of faith, we declare before you,
for
me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. And now, receive the blessing of the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you all. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the people of God declared, amen. Amen indeed. Go in peace. Have a wonderful week.